Now let's look at this conditional expectation. Till now we have looked at finding out the expected value, finding out the variance on one single variable. But conditional expectation is especially finding out the expected value or the mean and the variance, especially with respect to a conditional property given x equal to something. Find out the expected value. And one more thing that is being discussed in this chapter is the compound distribution. So like okay, there is a mixture of a Poisson distribution. Let's say we are talking about claim amount. There could be probably the whole total claim amount. I can break it into two parts. What could be is number of claims and probably average claim amount. These could be the two elements which I can take together to compute my total claim amount. And it may so happen that the total number of claims may be modeled using some discrete distribution like a Poisson or some kind of a distribution, because number of, it's a discrete. Whereas average claim amount, I can have it as a some conditional distribution, some continuous kind of a distribution like a log normal or something like that. Now when I'm combining these two, which can give me the claim amount, total claim amount prediction. The model for the total claim amount may come through this route. So there is a mixture of one discrete as well as as a continuous kind of a distribution. Those kind of things we are associating it to compound distribution. So we'll have to deal with even those kind of situations in this chapter. So to start with, so when we look at the conditional expectation, it is like you are finding out the mean given some other condition, like given x has already occurred. How do I find out the expected value of y? Again, this could be possible in a discrete case as well as a continuous case, right? Earlier we have done just the scenario of expected value of x, or we have found expected value of y, variance of x in isolation. But now we are talking about assuming that x has already occurred, find out the expected value of y. So that is the scenario of conditional expectation. So just by taking one example, we can see how we can accomplish in a discrete case. If I want to find out the expected value of x given y equal to 10. Expected value of x given y equal to 10. How do I find it out? So this is y equal to 10. Right? So logically, whatever we talk about the expected value, we talk in terms of the probability multiplied by the number. The number, the value multiplied by the corresponding probability is what we are calling as the expected value always. So now the only thing which you bring in case of conditional expectation is given, because this is y equal to 10, you take only this as your scope. And you make updated probabilities. What is the updated probability, which is the conditional probability itself? Because now you are given that y equal to 10. So the probability for x equal to 1 will become 0.2 by 0.4. right, which is 0.5. For x equal to 1, the probability is 0.5. For x equal to 2 also, the probability is 0.5. So now the expected value is nothing but 1 into 0.5 plus 2 into 0.5, which is coming out to 1.5. Given y equal to 10, right, if nothing is given, probably just to remind of our joint probability scenario. If nothing is given and it is asked to find out the expected value of x, right? What is that we have done? Without the probability being given, if I wanted to find out the expected value of x, we have taken it as you take all y's, right? So probably x equal to 1 and x equal to 2. Here the probability is 0.5. Here the probability is 0.5. For x equal to 1 means you are adding across all the y's. For all the y's multiplied by 1. So 0.5 for 1 into 1. Similarly 0.5 for 2 into 2, which is coming out to the same 1.5 itself. And even given y equal to 10 also, even if y equal to 10 is given, then only this part you are taking and you are finding out for x and y separately. The conditional probability is what you are finding out. So the conditional probability for this is 0.2 by 0.4, which is 0.5. This is also 0.5. So you are multiplying 1 into 0.5 plus 2 into 0.5, giving you 1.5. That is in case of discrete. In this case, even if it is not given y equal to 10, the conditional expectation came out to be the same, because across all the, for all y's, x equal to 1 is nothing but 0.5 itself, the probability. So adding up 0.2 plus 0.2 plus 0.1. So in that case, it is coming out to 0.5 and 0.5 only, but it is not the case always. Now, what do I do in case of continuous? The same logic. So because I want to find out the expected value of y, right here, I want to find out the expected value of y. So I have to multiply the y with the conditional probability given x. So how did I do the conditional probability here? In the discrete case, the probability of this divided by the total probability of this. This is what we have done. Here also, the probability of this, which is a combination of x and y, the probability of x comma y divided by whatever is given. The probability of whatever is given. In this case, y equal to 10 is given. Which is, that's the reason we have divided by the probability of this entire thing. So, if x is given for us in this question, the probability of x, which is f of x, that we are multiplying it by the corresponding values of x here. So here we have to multiply it by the corresponding y, and we are integrating it across the whole y. And how do I get f of x here? F of x is nothing but the marginal distribution, marginal probability of x, which means across all y, you have to integrate it. Now let's take one numerical, which will do the entire job for us, and try to solve it. Let x and y have the joint density function given by, so f of xy equal to 3 by 5 x into x plus y. So probably 3 by 5 into x squared plus xy. Okay. Where 0 is less than x less than 1, 0 less than y less than 2. Now I need to find out the conditional expectation of y given x equal to x. So for that, f of x comma y is available with me already. This is f of x comma y. Now I need to find f of x, which should be in the denominator, which is nothing but the marginal density function. That marginal density of marginal value of x here, if I want the marginal probability of x equal to 1, we are adding up all these probabilities of y. So here we have to integrate across all the y. Right, if I want to find out the value of x, right, the marginal density function of x equal to x, if I want, I have to add for all the values of y. Here also I have to integrate for all the values of y. So that's the reason I am integrating this across the whole of y. So y is lying between 0 to 2. 3 by 5 into x squared plus xy. So what is the integral here? This becomes x squared y, because I have to integrate it with respect to y, and this becomes x into y squared by 2. Because x squared is a constant, it became x squared y. This I am integrating between 2 and 0. So what is it coming out? 2x squared plus 2 squared is 4, 2, 4 by 2, 2y, 2x. 2x squared plus 2x is probably into 3 by 5. This is what is f of x across the whole y, or probably otherwise we are saying 6 by 5 x into x plus 1. This is f of x, and probably here also you can write it as 3 by 5 x into x plus y. This is f of x comma y. So probably f of x comma y divided by f of x. So x plus y by 2 into x plus 1. This is f of x comma y by f of x, which is nothing but the conditional probability of x. Right? The conditional probability of y given x equal to x. So this probably, if the question is just to find out the conditional probability of y, the answer stops here. If the question is about find the conditional probability of y in this question, we are stopping it here itself. But now the question for me is, find the expected value of y. Expected value of y means any expected value. The conditional probability, you are multiplying it with the value, and again you are integrating it. Here also, what did you do? If you wanted to find expected value of x equal to 1, you multiplied 1 by 0.5 and plus 2 by 0.5, 2 with 0.5, right? Which means you are multiplying for all combinations. Here you are integrating for all combinations, so which is nothing but you are doing x plus y by 2 into x plus 1, right? X plus y by 2 into x plus 1 is the conditional probability. This conditional probability, you are multiplying it with the value y, and you are integrating it across the whole of y. So typically coming out 2, so because the denominator is a constant now, I will take out 1 by 2 into x plus 1, I will take out 1 by 2 into x plus 1. And the numerator is xy. When you integrate it with respect to y, it becomes xy squared by 2 plus y squared. Integrate it with y, it becomes y cubed by 3. So you have to be just careful with the integration. What is the constant and all that? 1 by 2 into x plus 1. So this becomes 2x. 2 squared by 2, 4 by 2, 2x plus 8 by 3. So probably, 2 you can take out, x plus 4 by 3 by x plus 1. So this happens to be the expected value of y. Right, so probably if the question, so this numerical, if you practice, you can easily get finding out the expected value of x as well as y across all the combinations. So what is required in case of conditional expectation is you have to first find out the conditional probability first, which is given by f of x comma y by f of x equal to x. And f of x equal to x comes out with the marginal probability itself, where you are integrating it across the other variable. If you want f of x equal to x, you have to integrate it for all the y and vice versa. So once you have got, the conditional probability, you will multiply it with the corresponding values. And you integrate it again across all the y to get the expected value. That is what we do as a part of conditional expectation. The discrete part is more straightforward, whereas the continuous part requires some amount of integration like this. Fine? Okay. Now that we are able to find out the expected value of y, see, in our earlier example, we got the answer, expected value of y, we have got it as probably x plus 4 by 3 by x plus 1, right? Which means it is a variable itself. If the value of x changes, the expected value of y is changing, right? So, the expected value of y given x is not a constant. It's a variable. Expected value of y given x comes to you in the form of x. It does not come out as a constant. Correct? So, that is why we are calling even the expected value of y by x also as a random variable. Because depending on the value of x, x is a random variable. So, expected value of y given x, also we can take it as a random variable itself. Right? And we will see slightly later in our regression chapters as we move along. Even the expected value of y given x is another way of writing a regression line also. So, which means, because the slope of the line can keep changing, which means the expected value of y given x is also a kind of a random variable. So, if it is a random variable, means even that will have an expected value, that will have a variance. Right? And that is one important result for us here. Expected value of, this is a very important result for us. Expected value of y by x is nothing but expected value of y. Now, to just prove that, we have already solved this part. Expected value of, we have found out the expected value of y given x. Right, this is the expected value of y given x. Now, if I want to find out the expected value of this, right? If I simply find out the expected value of y, what is that I need to do? I integrate this across y, right? If I want the expected value of y, I will integrate it across y. Y into 3 by 5. This is nothing but the expected value of y. Right? So, if I am doing the integration of this, it is coming out. See, in the discrete case, if you wanted to find out expected value of x, all you are doing is x into 1 into the marginal probability of x. That is what we are doing, right? Or what you can say is you are multiplying all the x with all their corresponding probabilities. The x's you are multiplying with the corresponding probabilities and you are adding up, right? Either you find out here the conditional probability of y, sorry, the marginal probability of y. How do I find out the marginal probability of y? You integrate this over all x. You integrate this over all x to find out just f of y. You will get f of y if you integrate this across all x. So 3 by 5 into x squared is x cubed by 3 plus xy is y into x squared by 2 because you are integrating it across all x. This will give you f of y. Correct? So you are making it as 3 by 5 into 1 by 3 plus y by 2. Right? This is f of y. So if you want expected value of y, you integrate this y into f of y. Correct? So you are making it as 3 by 5 or probably 1 by 5. The first one if I am doing the first term. 1 by 5 into y squared by 2. This is between 2 and 0. And 3 by 10 into y cubed by 3. Correct? Y squared integration, y cubed by 3. This is also between 2 and 0. So the first one is becoming 2 squared by 2, 2 by 5. Whereas the second one is becoming 3 by 10 into 8 by 3, 8 by 10, 4 by 5. So overall this is coming out to 6 by 5. So expected value of y is coming out to 6 by 5. Correct? Now I need to find out even if the expected value of x, y given x also will come out to 6 by 5 or not. Right? So, all I can take is, so I got expected value of y given x. We got it as x plus 4 by 3 by x plus 1. Now, I need to find out the expected value of this. Which means I need to find out the expected value of this. Correct? If I want to find out the expected value of this, it is nothing but I'll do the integration, right, of this I'll do the integration of this across either f of x or f of y. I'll do the integration of this across this into, see, if I'm saying expectation of y into f of y, and you are integrating it. So if I want to say expectation of this into f of x, right? If I'm saying expectation of x into f of x, expectation of y into f of y. So the same way I'm saying y into f of something. So now I got f of y. We got f of y as this much. Or you can integrate this across x and y. Right? Simple logic. You integrate this across x and y. 0 to 1. 0 to 2. You integrate 0 to 1, 0 to 2, f of x comma y. So x plus 4 by 3 by x plus 1 into 3 by 5 x into x plus y. This entire thing you can integrate across x and y. So what is that you are getting? Probably if you integrate it, this integration is a slightly cumbersome process, because this integration or how much did we get for f of x earlier? We did not keep it, right? Now integrating this entire thing can be integrated. So probably we have to use the multiplication or a division rule itself. Okay, let's integrate it with respect to y first. If I am integrating it with respect to y, this entire thing is a constant, right? 3 by 5 x into x plus 4 by 3 by x plus 1 into this part will become xy plus y squared by 2. This will be integrated between 2 and 0. So this is becoming 3 by 5 x into x plus 4 by 3 by x plus 1 into, if I substitute it, it becomes, here it is easier. If I substitute, it becomes 2x plus 2, right? Yeah, 2x plus 2. So this is becoming x plus 1. I can strike this off. Now things are easy. So this is another 2. 6 by 5 is what is coming out, right? 2 into x plus 1. So that 2 is coming out as 6 by 5. Sorry? Why? In the numerator only, no? So 6 by 5 into x plus 4 by 3. This I have to integrate it with respect to x, 0 to 1. So 6 by 5 I am taking out. And x squared will become x cubed by 3. So x cubed by 3 is 1 by 3. substituting 1 and 0, plus 6 by 5 into 4 by 3 x. X is 1. So, what is this simplifying to 2 by 5 plus 8 by 5, which is coming out to 10 by 5. No. N by 5 is 2, right? How much did we get earlier? We got 6 by 5. Somewhere some small issue has come out. But it will get simplified to the same. Some calculation issue somewhere we might have made. So we may have to check that out. But what we will typically get is expectation of y will be same as expectation of y given x. Right, you are integrating it over x as well as over y. Whatever the thing you are going to get, it is going to be the same. Expectation of y will be the same as expectation of y given x. Either this would have been slightly different somewhere in our calculations, or the other one would have been different. You may have to just check out any small calculation issue that has cropped up in the process. Three by five x x plus 4 by 3 by x plus 1. Just try it out again, or let me also look at it. What you should typically get is expectation of y given x will be same as expectation of y itself. Right? So that's a typical relationship that you can take. Even in some of the questions, what he will do is he will give you the expectation of y given x. Right, and he may ask you to find out the expectation of that, which is nothing but sometimes he may give expectation of y and also expectation of y given x, and asking you to find out expectation of y given x, which is nothing but if you can directly write the value of expected value of y itself for it. Right? All right. Now, the same logic, just like the way expected value of y given x is a random variable, even variance of y given x also is a random variable. Right? Because again, it will also come in the form of y given x only. Because the variance of y given x is nothing but this one. It's an expected value of. See, just like variance of what is the formula for variance of y? We said expected value of x y squared minus expected value of y whole squared, right? In our individual case. So, when you are saying given x across, here also you will put given x. That's the only difference. Right? So, just like the way we are finding out with respect to unconditional scenario, even in a conditional scenario also, we are operating it in the same way. So, now if I want to find out something like this, find out the variance of y given x equal to 1. So, what is that I need to find out? First, I need to find out expected value of y given x. And then, y squared given x. What is the expected value of y given x? Expected value of y given x for me is 10. Y you multiply it with the conditional probabilities. Right? Y equal to 1. So, what is the expected value of y given x? See, normally if you are finding out the expected value of y, we are talking about 10 into 0.2 plus 10 into 0.2, something like this. Now, when we are going with the expected value of y given x, so I am trying to find out for each value of x, right? When x is given as 1 here, x is given as 1, what is the expected value of y for me? 10 into 0.2 by 0.5, correct? 20 into 0.2 by 0.5 plus 30 into 0.1 by 0.5. This is the expected value of y given x, which will work out as 10 into, let's say, 0.4, 4, plus 20 into 0.4, 8, plus 30 into 0.2, 6. is your expected value of x. Now, what is the expected value of y squared given x? The same logic. 100 into 0.4 plus 400 into 0.4 plus 900 into 0.2. How much is it coming out? 40 plus 160 plus 180, which is working out to 380. So, variance of y given x is nothing but expectation of x squared, y squared, expectation of y squared given x minus expectation of y given x whole squared, 18 squared, which is working out to some 56. So, the standard deviation is square root of 56. If the question is about variance, I'll stop it at 56 layer. Otherwise, I can go up to the square root of 56, finding out the standard deviation. Now, what he is saying is, again, another formula. If the question is about just finding out the variance of y alone, not variance of y given x. Here the variance of y given x we have found out through this method. Right? Now, if the question is about finding out just variance of y, all he is saying is find out the expectation of variance of y given x plus variance of expectation of y given x. That is what will give you the variance of y. Probably this is the result which can be remembered, right? It's just a translation of expected values and the variances, which is a very big application in your compound distributions. When we are talking about two different distributions present, we use the same logic, right? Expectation of y, if you want, it is nothing but expectation of y given x. In our previous slide, we have got the result. If I want the expectation of y, it is nothing but expectation of y given x. If I want variance of y, I can find it out as expectation of variance of y given x plus variance of expectation of y given x. So, this formula, even in this case, right now we know, if you see, variance of y given x, for x equal to 1 we found out, right, for x equal to 1 we have found out. Similarly, for x equal to 2 also you can find out the variance. So, based on those two, you multiply by their corresponding x, you will get expected value of variance of y given x. See, variance of y given x, we got it as 56 for x equal to 1, right? probably we may get another 50, another some 36 for, let's say, x equal to 2, right? So if you are finding out this one, it is nothing but 1 into 56 plus 2 into 36. Again, assuming that I've got 36. So this is what will become the expected value of variance of y given x. For all values of x, I am finding out their variances, variance of y given x, and I am doing a multiplication and addition. Now, the same logic, expected value of y given x, for x equal to 1, we got expectation of y given x as 18, right? It is becoming x equal to 1. Right, for x equal to 1, the variance is 18. For x equal to 2, the variance could be something else. The expected value. The expected value is something else. Let's say some 30. Now I can find out the variance of this random variable again. Right, find out the expected value of this. Then expected value of y squared minus expected value of y whole squared, which will give you the variance of y in totality. Right? If at all the question is given, just the raw data is given, and he is asking you to find out the variance of y, we may have to do this kind of a logic. Right? Now, another thing that this chapter is stressing out on is the compound distributions, especially when there are multiple random variables like this, x1, x2, x3. Let's say there are n different claims, each with a different claim amount. So, S is the total number of claims, total claim amount. X1, X2, X3 are different claims, individual claims. Xn, so there are n claims which are coming up, and S is the total claim amount. So there are two random variables here. N is one random variable. You don't know how many claims are going to come up in a particular day. So that is one random variable. And what is the typical claim size? What is the average claim size, or what is the claim value corresponding to the ith claim? So these are the two variables that are existing with you, but you are more interested in modeling the total claim amount. We are not looking at individual claim. So that is where we call them as compound distributions, especially the sum of n different claims, each one being random, and even the total, the n itself is random, how many. So such kind of distributions, we are calling them as compound distributions, right? They could both of them, n as well as x, both of them may be same distribution, may be different distributions, but because we have of the form, number is also something not known, and each independent value is also not known. So that's where what they say is, if at all I have to make some prediction about the claim amount, total claim amount, it is said that you find out the expected value of n as well as expected value of x and multiply them. That will give you the expected value. So wherever compound distributions are there, if you want the expected value of the total, you find the expected value of the total number, what is the expected number of claims that can come out, multiplied by the expected value of the claim size, average claim. So, and because that is again subjected to variance, the way the variance is coming out is, expected value of n into variance of x plus variance of n into expected value of x whole square. This is again a result for us. So if I simply look at the better way, probably we take this example. There are n claims, x1, x2, x3. So the claims are I mean the average claim amount are following a Poisson distribution, and n is following a binomial distribution. Right? X's are following a Poisson distribution, and n is following a binomial distribution. If that's the case, how do I find out the mean and variance of S? We said expected value of S is equal to expected value of n into expected value of x. What is the expected value of n? N is a binomial variable. Binomial variable, the expected value is NP. Multiplication of 10 and 0.2. So the expected value of n is 2, because it's in a binomial distribution, the expected value is nothing but NP. And the variance is NP into 1 minus P. So these are all present as a part of your actuarial tables also. Okay, expected value of n is 2. What is the expected value of x? X is a Poisson distribution. Lambda. This is lambda. So the expected value variance, both of them are lambda for a Poisson distribution. So this is lambda, which is 5. So the expected claim amount is 10. What is the variance in the claim amount now? You can use this formula. Expected value of n, which is 2, into variance of x. Variance of Poisson distribution is again 5, plus variance of n into expected value of x whole square. Expected value of x is 2, right? Variance of n. Okay, NP into 1 minus p. So 10 into 0.2, 2 into 0.8, 1.6. Variance of n is 1.6 into expected value of x squared is 25. So probably the variance of the distribution is 10 plus 40. 50 is the variance. The mean is 10. So the total claim amount will have an average of 10 units with a variance of 50 units. Right? So if you have to predict the total claim, if in case the claim amounts are following a Poisson distribution and the average number of claims is following a norm, binomial distribution, we can also two distributions. If I want for a compound distribution, if I want the mean and the variance of a compound distribution, we follow this kind of a logic. And if at all I want to find out the moment generating functions, instead of finding out directly the variance or the mean kind of stuff, if at all I want to find out the moment generating function, again both here two variables are involved, n as well as x. What it says is the moment generating function of s can be taken as the moment generating function of n log mx of t. So first you find out the moment generating function of x. Then you take a logarithm, which is nothing but the cumulant generating function of x. The moment you take log of m of x, it is nothing but cumulant generating function. So you take the moment generating function of the cumulating generating function of x. Right? For example, Here also, if you wanted, in the same example, you have to first find out the moment generating function of the Poisson distribution, because that is x. Whatever is the moment generating function of Poisson distribution, right? Probably you can check out for the moment generating function of the Poisson distribution from the tables. Take the logarithm of that. So that, take it as t and take it as input into the binomial distribution's moment generating function. For example, in this example, let's say find out, write down the moment generating function of the compound Poisson distribution with individual claim size. Individual claim size is following a gamma distribution, and the Poisson parameter is lambda. So for a Poisson distribution, it is the moment generating function is e power lambda into e power t minus 1. The moment generating function of a Poisson distribution, probably you can check out from the tables, or you can derive also. We have seen expected value of e power tx will give us the moment generating function. So this is coming out, this will work out to e power lambda into e power t minus 1. So if I am substituting that, so I need to substitute this in place of t. So it becomes e power lambda into e power log mx of t minus 1. In place of t, I am putting log mx of t. So what is this becoming? This is directly becoming mx of t. E power log x is nothing but x. So this is coming out to e power lambda into mx of t minus 1. Here this mx of t I need for a gamma distribution. For a gamma distribution, the mx will come out to whatever. You have to check out what is the moment generating function for a gamma distribution. Typically it is 1 minus lambda minus t to the power alpha into gamma of alpha. This is the moment generating function for a gamma distribution, which means your answer will end out to be something like this. See, most common question which we may typically get is, once a number wise it would be given the two different distributions of a compound distribution, and you are asked to find out the expected value as well as the variance, just like the above example. You are asked to find out what is the expected value and variance of that compound distribution. So probably we can take one or two more examples.
I thought I had a couple of examples.
See, for the moment generating function, you have to refer to the actuarial tables itself. You just need to take out those values and you can substitute. That's not a big deal. Now let's say for this example, the number of claims has a negative binomial distribution. This is the negative binomial distribution which is being talked about. For the number of claims, claim amounts have a gamma distribution. Now, for the total amount, if I want to find out the mean, it is nothing but expected value of n into expected value of s or x. So, what is the expected value of a negative binomial distribution? We can check it out. What is the expected value for a negative binomial distribution? Expected value of a gamma distribution is alpha by lambda. So alpha by lambda is giving us 6 by 2. The expected value of a gamma distribution is 3. Whereas the expected value of a negative binomial,
when did it give the solution?
if we see here, the expected value of the gamma distribution is 3. And the variance of the gamma is alpha by lambda square. So, 6 by 2 square coming out to 1.5. Similarly, the expected value of the binomial, okay, it is negative. For the negative binomial, it is 1 minus p by p. Okay. It is 1 minus p into 1 minus p x of x, right? Let's check out what is the, probably you can check out the expected value of the negative binomial works out to x into 1 minus p by p. Yeah, I think so. So, expected value of n is coming out as k, which is 3, into 1 minus p. P is given as 0.9. So, 3 into 1 minus 0.9, which is 0.1 by 0.9. That is what is coming out as expected value of n. Variance of n is coming out as k into 1 minus p by p squared, which is coming out as 10 by 27. Now, if I want to find out the expected value of y, which is nothing but expected value of x into expected value of n, 3 into 1 by 3, 1. If I want to find out the variance of y, I am doing expected value of n into variance of x plus variance of n, 10 by 27, into expected value of x square, 3 square. So, this is what is working out to whatever is the variance, and from there you can find out the standard deviation in the data. And the same way, if they are asking about the moments, so you are directly getting the moment generating function for a negative binomial distribution. The value is directly available from your tables. P, it looks like P by 1 minus P into e power t to the power x, to the power k. That is the moment generating function for a negative binomial, which you can easily make out from the values which he has substituted here. P by 1 minus of 1 minus p into e power t to the power x to the power k. That is what is the moment generating function for a negative binomial. Whereas the moment generating function for gamma distribution is 1 minus t by lambda to the power minus alpha. 1 minus t by lambda to the power minus alpha is looking like the moment generating function for a gamma distribution. So, for a combined, we have given that it is nothing but mn of, you are substituting in place of t, you will substitute log of this one, e power log of this particular mx of t. That is what you substitute, which is where you are getting 1 minus of 0.1 into whatever that mx of t you are getting, 1 minus t by 2 to the power minus 6 whole cube. A simple way of writing the moment generating function. So, all you require is take the moment generating functions from the actuarial tables, from where you can just substitute one inside the other in place of t. You will get the moment generating function of the compound distribution. So, the most common question from this chapter always remains to be like, for the compound distribution, finding out the expected value as well as the variance, and in case of conditional probabilities being given, finding out the expected value of y, variance of y given x, Those are the two important areas that needs to be comfortable in this chapter. Right?